you. I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. 'Cause when you call my name, into your glorious day, you call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Come on, shout, he's alive.
When you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name, you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Come on, I need to rescue.
I need to rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name,
I ran out of that grave,
out of the dark,
to your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
You call my name,
and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, to your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Oh, come on, somebody. Somebody lift up a shout of praise in this place.
Experience a generation of people who know who they are because they know who their God is. And our God is Yahweh, and He is the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Beside Him there is no other. Without Him there is no victory, but with Him all things are possible. Somebody praise the name of the Lord.
going to begin a series this morning. This is part one of a series entitled Grave Clothes. I think that's appropriate for Easter because Jesus left the grave clothes in the tomb. They wrapped him. They thought he was dead. But somebody guess what? He was alive. Now watch this. We're going to begin. I'm going to let you guys back there control that if you don't mind. We know that Jesus was alive because the Word tells us in John chapter 20, beginning with verse 3, it says, "So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first." Now, I've spoken on this before, and I've talked about what would cause the other disciple to outrun Peter. Peter was the one that said, "Jesus, I'm never going to leave you. I'm going to be with you till the end, man. There is nobody, nothing going to separate you and me." But how many knows it was Peter that denied Jesus three times? I think Peter, when he heard that Jesus was alive, man, he took off and he started running toward that tomb. But then the thought occurred to him, wait a minute. I don't know how fast I really want to be because God knows I denied Jesus three times. The other disciple reached the tomb first. He says he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen. Now we have some strips of linen here on a grave table. Some strips of linen that were lying there, but he did not go in. He looked in, he saw the strips of linen, but he didn't go in. It says, "Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb." He saw the strips of linen lying there. The Word says, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Now, this is not my notes this morning, but where's Aaron at? Aaron, wave at me. Where are you at? He's back there. I think he snuck across the street and had something to eat. I said, you know, it's interesting that the Word brought such detail to the state of the tomb. It said that the linen was lying there, and we've got some linen here this morning. The grave clothes were lying there, but the cloth that was wrapped around his head was separate from the linen. And I said, I wonder why that is. I wonder why that is. And Aaron said, well, I think I know why it is, but I'm not sure. I said, well, tell me, Aaron. He said, because Jesus died and he rose again so that our body could be made whole. But he also died so that our mind could be in freedom. And that was a good thought. Might have a preacher on our hands. This is what Jesus did for us, and this is what the first Easter morning looked like. Can we pray this morning? Father, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you that you left your grave clothes behind, Father. We thank you that you left the tomb empty, God. Lord, they laid you in the tomb, and for 3 days, Lord, you were there. God, but the Word tells us that your spirit descended into hell and defeated Satan and took the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and you rose again victorious, full of life, full of power. And your Word says the same power that raised you from the dead dwells within us, God. And we give you praise for it. In Jesus' name, everybody shouted. Amen. Somebody say, thank God for the grave clothes. Thank you, band. I appreciate that. The title of my message this morning, Grave Clothes is a series. The title of my message this morning is No Fooling, It Really Happened. Now, today's Easter, but it's also April Fool's Day. I don't know how that happened. But can I tell you, it is no fooling, it's no joke. It really happened. Jesus died and he rose again. Look at somebody say, no fooling. It really happened. All right, listen to this. John 23, verse 8 says, "Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside and he saw and believed. they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had risen from the dead. They didn't understand what it meant, that Jesus had been preparing them and telling them, there's coming a day where I'm going to die, I'm going to be crucified, there's going to be no more life within me, but it's okay because on the third day, something special is going to happen. They didn't understand. Listen, it says that the grave clothes were laying there. They were laying on the table for them to see. And they still didn't understand what happened to Jesus. You see, there comes a time in our life when we must always choose to believe even if there is no understanding. God, I don't understand how this could happen. I don't understand how you can be Lord. I don't understand how you can be in my circumstance even though it looks bad. I don't understand how you can be in the tomb, your presence in the tomb, when things seem to be desperate and without hope and when it seems like there's no way out. I don't understand how you could still be in control, but I can choose to believe. You may not understand. You may not understand why you're in the season that you're in today. You may not understand why God has brought you to this place today. But you can choose to believe that Jesus is Lord and He's alive and well and He's in control. John 20 verse 11 says this. Now Mary stood outside the tomb and she was crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been. Now think about this. They were seated on the tomb table in the empty tomb. You got two angels sitting there waiting for Mary and the disciples to arrive. They were waiting for them. And she was crying. And she saw the two angels in white seated where Jesus' body would have been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" Can I paraphrase or can I interject here? Didn't Jesus already tell you this was going to happen? How many know sometimes God will tell you something, but you really don't believe it? Well, there ain't no way that could ever happen. "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. Now listen to this. She saw him standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. We're talking about Mary. She didn't even understand that it was Jesus standing there behind her. And the word tells us, it says, He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" He didn't say, "No, look, I rose from the dead. Why are you crying?" He just said, "Why are you crying? Who is it that you are looking for?" He's like, "Hello, it's me." How many times has Jesus been near us and we didn't even recognize him? How many times have you been in a church service and the presence of God is so strong, but you're so wrapped up and consumed with your circumstances and your situations and your heartache and your despair that you don't even recognize that He's there? There are so many times that Jesus is right there with you and we fail to recognize Him. It says, thinking that He was the gardener, Mary said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him." Then Jesus said to her, "Mary." How many knows when Jesus calls your name? When all of a sudden salvation is no longer about your grandparents or what your parents believed, or what God's doing for the person next to you, but Jesus says, "Robert. I died for Robert. I died for Ben. I died for Pamela. I died for Jazz. I died." Listen, salvation is always personal. Relationship is always personal. Now, God said that He so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son. So He died for the world. But can I tell you, there are times where you need to make it personal and let Jesus call your name. I believe if you are sitting under the sound of my voice this morning, whether you're in the room or you're one of the hundreds that watch all over the world, I'm telling you that Jesus has called you by name. The Bible says that you are a friend of God. It says, Mary, and she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. You see, Jesus said this simple phrase. He said, my sheep listen to my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Until Jesus called her by name, she did not recognize him. But at that moment, she heard the voice of Jesus, and she was willing to follow him. Look at somebody and say, no fooling. He's really alive. Verse 19 says this, on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came in and stood among them and said, peace be with you. It's one of my favorite Star Trek stories of the Bible. The disciples are in the room. There's no way in, there's no ways out. They're scared of the Jewish leaders, and they're scared of what might happen to them because of what happened to Jesus. They're scared of persecution. The doors are locked. And then Jesus just says, I ain't scared of no locked door. I'm going to walk right in, and I'm going to stand in their midst. Can I tell you, you can lock the doors of your heart. You can lock the doors of your life. You can lock the doors. You can say, man, there's no way. I'm not letting him in. This Christianity stuff is not for me. But I can tell you that there could come a day where Jesus could walk right in the middle of your circumstance, right in the middle of your situation and say, hey, peace be with you. There's no locked door that scares Jesus. You think you're going to keep him out? Listen, after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. You see, let me tell you, your grave clothes may have came off. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I believe that your grave clothes come off. That old, nasty, dead man is no more. Your grave clothes come off, and Jesus deals with the grave clothes, but when your grave clothes come off, your scars remain. What makes you think if the scars of Jesus still remain that yours aren't going to remain? Somebody says, well, the past is the past. Absolutely, it sure is. But Jesus will leave the scars so that he can remind you of what he saved you from. Hey, I'm alive and I have breath to breathe, and I've been saved and I've been bought with the blood of Jesus, and I have a testimony, and it's shown in my scars. There's some hurt in my life. There's some pain in my life. Listen, Jesus endured the agony of the cross, but he had the scars to prove that God saved him from the agony of the cross. There's some of you that have hurts and pains from marriages and relationships and things that have happened to you, maybe even as a child, some things that you've walked through that have left some scars. But rather than letting the scars dictate your life, allow the scars to be an example of what your God can do. Hey, I was in the tomb. The devil thought he had me beat. The devil thought that he had me under his feet. But I've got the grave clothes and the scars to prove that my God is alive. Scars serve as reminders of what God saved you from. And scars serve as your testimony of what God has done in your life. Some of you have a testimony. I used to be an alcoholic. I used to be a drug addict. I used to be a fornicator. I used to be lost into sin. But I've got scars and I've got grave clothes to prove that God can save anybody. Without the scars and without the grave clothes, listen, without what Jesus did on the cross and in the grave. You know, we talk about the cross all the time, but I think it's significant what took place in the grave. Without what Jesus did, none of us would have hope. Pastor Travis would be a lost old sinner just like everybody else. I'm telling you, we all have a testimony because of what Jesus did in the grave. Verse 21 says this. Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He's like, "Yeah, but what were you drinking? You all locked up in that room." "Yeah, you've seen the Lord." He says, but he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Look at somebody and say, "No fooling." He thought this was the first April Fool's Day is what he thought. Like, man, y'all trying to get one over on me. I ain't going to buy it. I'm not going to buy it. Until I see it for myself, until I feel it for myself, can I remind you that God wants salvation to be personal? No fooling, he's really alive. Verse 26 says, a week later, his disciples were in the house again, and this time Thomas was with them. And Jesus said, "Hey, if they want a do-over, I'll do it." Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them again and said, "Peace be with you." He says that because he just scared the doo-doo out of them. My wife said, "Don't say doo-doo on Easter." No, I'm just kidding. Now I said it twice. Verse 27 said, he said to Thomas, "Hey, Thomas, I wasn't here when you told the disciples you didn't believe, but go ahead and put your fingers here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop your doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are the people in 2018 who are sitting in a church building, who have not seen the scars, who have not seen the grave clothes, but they believe anyway because they understand that there's a God who cares for them, a God who loves them, and a God who died for them. And a God who rose again and is seated at the right hand of the Father, who is praying, 'God, I want Scott to experience my love today.'" The Bible says he's interceding on your behalf. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Look at somebody and say, "No fooling. He's really alive." Because he's alive, you may have new life yourself. Because he shed his grave clothes. Because he shed his grave clothes in the tomb and rose victorious. The Bible says the same power that rose him from the dead dwells in you. That same power gives you the power to have new life as well. You see, the cross is very powerful and very significant. But the cross without the empty tomb is pointless. Jesus died so that we could have grace. But he rose again so that we could have keys to death, hell, and the grave. And could live a victorious life with him. Because he died, you can come alive as well. You see, your grave clothes are the proof that the old man is dead. You would not have liked the old Travis, I can tell you. The old Travis was arrogant, had a bad temper, had very little faith. The old Travis was not a very good guy. But I've got the grave clothes to prove that that Travis is dead. That Travis is in the grave, and I can tell you, I'm not going to dig him back up. I'm going to use the grave clothes to prove to myself and to the world that God can take an old, nasty sinner, crucify him, bury him in the ground, and raise to life one that is new, that is full of power, that is full of authority, and that is full of the grace of God that can cause us to abound in every good thing. Your grave clothes are the proof that the old man is dead. Let me tell you, never forsake your testimony. Never be ashamed of your testimony. Never be ashamed of what God has done in your life, but rather put your grave clothes on display and say, hey, God can save me from this, therefore God can save you from anything. Look at somebody and say, no fooling. He's really alive. Your grave clothes are the proof that the new man, not just the old man is dead, but your grave clothes are proof that the new man is alive. Alive in Christ. Jesus said that he came to give us life and life more abundantly. Properly interpreted, it says that he came to give us life to the overflowing. He came to give us life to the overflow. God didn't save you so that you could survive in life. God saved you so you could thrive in life. So that you can do things for the kingdom of God. So that you can make a difference in the world that you live in. Your grave clothes are the proof that the new man is alive. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this. Therefore, if anyone, somebody say anyone. Look at your neighbor and say, that means you. I could have said that even means you. That'd be worse. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. All things. You are not your past. Can I tell you that? Whoever you were yesterday, you don't have to be anymore. You know what the devil would say? He's like, look, this is you. This is the real you. This is who you're always going to be. You're always going to be a screw up. You're always going to mess up. You're always going to fail. You're never going to amount to anything. You're never going to accomplish anything. Every time you try to live for God, you end up messing up. Therefore, just give up, quit, just do whatever. Just come to church on Christmas and eat whatever. You know, he lies to you all day long. But no, those old things, whoever you are yesterday, should never dictate who you are today. I am a new creation. The Bible says his mercies are new every morning. The old has passed away. Behold, all things become new. Can I tell you, all you have to do is believe. We see the grave clothes laying here. We see the empty tomb. Just like the disciples, they saw it, but they didn't understand. They didn't believe. Mary saw it, but she didn't believe. She thought somebody stole the body of Christ. But look, all you have to do is believe. Hey, Jesus really did die for me. He really rose again for me. Mary, teacher. Verna, he died for you. Kevin, he died for you. Quay, he died for you. Listen, I'm telling you that Jesus really did this. Listen, that's all it says. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, do we really believe he left the grave clothes behind so that he could be the Lord of our life? All you really have to do is believe. Look at somebody and say, no fooling. He's really alive. Would you stand with me this morning?